Welcome back to Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I am Chat Show. How are you? I've missed you horribly. It's only been a week. I've been in Nolens. I repeat, New Orleans. Since last Sunday when I left here, working on a motion picture. As much as I can tell, the pictures seem to be moving. Yeah. Vinnie Jones, soccer star slash hoodlum.
Hooligan.
In this case, no.
No?
I thought hooligan.
Yeah.
He is gangster.
Well.
Yeah.
Around these parts.
He took me to see Tom Jones at the House of Blues.
Okay.
I tweeted a photograph of the three of us. It's clear which one's the
Wait,
Jew in the photo.
This weekend? This week?
This last week.
You don't tell me anything.
Well, there's a reason.
For the show.
There's a reason for that. A, we'll find out where you were this past week when we get to you. B, it's on a need to care basis for you.
I'm interested in Tom Jones.
Yeah. 74 years old, by the end of the show, or when we left, may not have been the end, there were a half dozen, good-sized panties. Probably granny panties at this point.
Yeah.
But on the stage. And I said to Vinnie Jones, my new best friend, you think anyone's going to be throwing their panties at you when you're 74? Just curious. You think that's going to happen?
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, having a great time there in New Orleans and rediscovering just what a spectacular city that is. And how dare the earth swallow the place in water for a while? Fuck the earth. In the eye for that nonsense.
Sure.
And way to go, U.S. government, again, for snapping into action and helping those people out. Sammy, Jamie, how was your week? Jamie, let's start with you. You were on the other side of the planet in the nation's Wang, I believe.
Yes, I was in Florida.
Uh-huh.
Because Nevada makes my butt look big. That was for you.
Oh, I know.
So sense. Now I went to Disney World, as usual. I try to go twice a year.
Uh-huh.
It was a pretty good trip. Rained a lot.
Yeah.
But I met up with a, I guess now friend, but a fan of the chat show.
Yeah.
Who is also a big Disney fan.
The Nerdy Fox.
Nerdy Fox, who I found out, and I'm totally calling him out on this because it really upset me. Last name, not Fox.
No!
He changed it.
Because?
Whenever he was 18, he wanted to change it. He wanted to change his name, and he always liked the last name Fox. He said it was after Matthew Fox.
First of all, what 18-year-old changes their last name who's not in show business?
And Matthew Fox, what? Not Michael J?
He's like, well, I always like the last name Fox because I'm a big fan of like Michael J. Fox and Matthew Fox. But I think he was a big Lost fan, and it was mostly
well,
because of Matthew
clear.
Fox.
Well, clear. He better be a big Lost fan.
Or a Party of Five fan, probably.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I was a little, like, I don't know. I took it to heart.
But you had a nice tweet up with Nerdy Fox.
But he's my name.
Has he been in the chat room on a few shows?
Yes.
Yeah, because he tweets about the show, I know.
It's Nerd Fox, Nerdy Fox. I think
Nerd
Fox. His name's Zach. Zach Fox.
Mm-hmm.
Air quotes.
No relation.
No.
As it turns out.
Not at all.
Not even close.
But he's a nice young boy.
His real last name is Bishop. That's an inside joke for
yes.
Jamie Fox fans. And Sammy, how was your week?
My week's, it's empty without you here.
Well.
You know that.
But you were in my home.
Well, I'm often in your home while you're not here. That's, yeah, sorry.
Because Jamie and I were both out of town, it turns out the weekly poker game went a little late.
A little late this week.
Did you finish before the paper boy came?
Well, I am your paper boy.
A.
You come all the way from Sherman Oaks?
Yep.
That is, you download the news onto my computer.
I download the news onto you, then I print it out for you. Right. I'm doing this really poorly.
Oh, man.
Next week I'll be in
You'll be in Mom's.
The New York area.
You'll be, yeah.
So I will not be here. I'm very sad about that.
Yeah, I'm sure.
How late did the game go? I didn't know any of this. How late did the game go?
Round three.
Yeah. No, I'm sure Edie. I'm sure Edie was fine.
She had no idea what was going on.
Nope.
No idea.
And you dominated the game again.
I don't know. I got lucky.
Greg, tough night.
Poor guy. This is, by the way, what our fans want to hear about.
Yes.
Who won and lost at your poker?
Yeah, it's true. Well, I get emails all the time. Please tell us the outcome of your weekly poker game. We don't know anything.
I'm dubious.
Tell us what you would like to hear on the show. We'd love to hear from you. Thank you for the encouragement there, Sam, to refocus my attention on the audience. write to us at contact@kevinpollackschatshow.com. Contact@kevinpollackschatshow.com. And let us know What the fuck? You've sent us some Larry King games. I appreciate that. J-Mac has got them to me. And next Sunday, the 11th, if you're watching us live, Dana Gould will be our guest host. First guest host we've had on purpose. There was one time I think Sammy sat in for me while I was late getting in from the airport or something.
Yeah, I sat in for all of 3.5 minutes.
Oh, right. But it was delightful.
Yeah. And then, Sam, you're going to guest host the show in June, too, which I'm very excited about. So we'll keep you posted on that. Follow us on the Twitter, at Sam Levine, at Jamie Foxx.
No, it's J-A-I-M-E underscore F-O-X.
Yeah.
You have to spell it.
And I'm at Eric Bishop. Nope. I think that's it for the old news. Let's get to the new news, shall we? I know him as our man in Amsterdam. You may know him as a television star. Too much pressure?
Star.
That's cool.
Please welcome
Thank you, Jordan Peele. Thank you.
Jordan, your birth name, Jordan Peele, by the way?
Birth name, Jordan Peele.
Uh-huh.
My mother considered calling me Noah, but that I would have been Noah Peele. And that's not a bit. That's not a bit. It's I've told that joke throughout my life, but that is supposedly true.
And was it biblically and the genesis of the name?
Is it? Yes. My mother is she's Episcopalian.
Sure.
And she loves biblical imagery and stuff. But I believe I asked her about it recently because I was always under the impression she wanted to name me something biblical that had to do with water.
Ah.
And so I think Noah and Jordan, last time I asked her and reminded her about this, she said, no, that wasn't it. That was not actually it. And I can't remember, what, but it's weird how we build these little things throughout our lives that we have somehow just gotten in our head as true. And no, maybe she said that as some kind of, offhanded, finding the connection. And
right.
No, it's not the case.
Not the case at all.
No.
The Our Man in Amsterdam reference from your dossier. Thank you, Jason McIntyre.
Thank you.
I'm very curious at the get, if you don't mind,
mm-hmm.
about the Boom Chicago cast swap with Second City.
Yes.
And what a trip I have to assume it was, but I'm going to need some details.
Okay.
Had you been to the Europes prior?
Never been to the Europes.
Right.
Any of the Europes I had never been to.
Right.
I was about 20.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Prime meat.
I'll say.
For the Amsterdammers.
Yeah.
So this company, Boom Chicago, is just, it's this amazing comedy theater that a couple guys from Chicago.
Expats.
Went to Amsterdam for grad school. And said, what if we could live here and do comedy and
as a front, and then of course
and then
steal
smoke
drugs
weed
behind.
And fuck prostitutes for a living. Is that a possibility? No. They don't
pay tax.
I don't know that they fuck prostitutes.
No, we don't.
They haven't told me that any of that story. But it's legal there.
Sure.
And it's unionized.
So it's just assumed that they do this.
I think we can all assume that they do.
If they're gonna be in storefronts.
That's right. That's right. And now, they all have Dutch wives and families, and everything is, they're there, the Boom Chicago people. But it's just a great theater that really kind of capitalized on the idea that everybody, it's a tourist town in Europe, and one thing tourists have in common is they speak English, often better than the Americans, better than we do. So this was the only place, wherever you're from, you can come and see some comedy without having to go, listen to the awful, awful language that is Dutch.
Yeah, the comedy stylings of that accent. And it's sketch comedy for the most part.
It's a sketch comedy show,
right.
And then it's broken up with improv, so short form improv. And I had been in Chicago living there for a couple years, and this where it's have a little artsy sort of the integrity of these training centers of Second City and Improv Olympic were valued, and this was a show that is just put on as a spectacle. So they had, you know, they integrate really early, were integrating video and improv and video, and they would go out into the audience and project the image of the audience member for the crowd to see, and then go backstage and you come out and you impersonate the audience member. And this really just absolutely fun show.
Yeah.
And so that was where I was there 3 years. It was like that was the 10,000 hours of, you know, six nights a week doing improv, getting to do some crowd work, getting to.
But Hamburg was for the Beatles.
Exactly. Amsterdam was for me.
That's great.
And Hitler probably went to both places.
Yeah. Well, he had a sense of humor.
He had a sketch comedy troupe too.
Sketch comedy group.
Where is it?
Hitler's underwear. It's not just a common name for sketch comedy. That was the original.
That was the original one. It was It's long underwear, but it's long form.
Yeah.
Underwear. But yes,
he's the, not a monster.
But. Yes, and it's still there. It's still rocking. I haven't been back in a few years, but you know, I've met some amazing people along
the way.
Yeah,
ended up when you were working at Mad TV. There were several, or
yes,
a couple at least from
Ike Barinholtz, Josh Myers. Right. You know, the Seth Myers, also an alum. Some great people, Kay Cannon, Nicole Parker, the list goes on. We have Colton Dunn, who's one of the writers on my show, that I met there, Becky Drysdale, as well. And so it was just one of these awesome, unique little scenes where everybody kind of spurred each other along and inspired each other.
Yeah.
And so I was there 3 years, cut to, in the middle of my third year, there was this, I don't know who, Andrew Moskos is kind of the wheeler and dealer, CEO type guy. Of course, he's not a real CEO type. He's a wheeler and a dealer. these guys, like, they went and they were, they started off promoting their own show, and that was kind of part of the whole deal of Boom Chicago. As you went there, you'd have to go out and promote the show. By the time I got there, they had a promotions department.
Sure.
And
initially, they were handing out tickets like they do in Times Square.
Yes.
And always, nothing makes Jamie laugh harder, in fact, that I've witnessed, than when she and I are unfortunately spending 9 seconds walking near Times Square, and someone puts a tickets in our hands and says to me, would you like to go to a free stand-up comedy show? And that's, it makes her so happy that they don't know who I am.
Yes, I that's, you are the butt of that one,
So you would, they did that before that, so by the time you got there, you didn't have to do it?
Didn't have to do that. They had us taken care of. It was great. And coming from, Chicago, you're just hustling, trying to get not even get paid, just to get up on stage and get to do improvisation. It's just kind of a clusterfuck over there.
Yeah.
With everybody's trying to do the same thing. So, you're lucky if you get to do a show a week.
In
Chicago. So all of a sudden in Boom Chicago,
everybody's working.
We're all stars.
You know,
getting stage time.
Where's everybody staying? It's like
they got, and by the way,
they had their own youth hostel?
Essentially. They put us up in different homes. They got, we got working permits.
Right.
But the actual Boom Chicago Theater, at the time it was the Liza Klein Theater, was kind of this clubhouse and had this office. And sometimes you'd sleep on the couch of the office if you didn't make it out after the show. And then, that's the other thing. There was a bar downstairs, so that was part of the
at 20 years
fun.
Old.
Yeah.
What a wonderful influence.
Yeah. This is why comedians are addicts here. As we get off the stage right into a bar, and then you add a
hash.
You add the hash.
Your opiates.
Yeah. And time of my life.
Mom was thrilled at this opportunity.
Mom was
for you?
Totally thrilled.
Sure.
Totally. First of all, loves Amsterdam. And Amsterdam's got kind of a bad rap, we hear about the skeezy side
of it. It's an artsy haven as well.
And it's beautiful.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. And it has so much going for it. The people are beautiful. It has so many great sides to it. I mean, Dutch people are blunt. There is an edge that, I went there thinking, oh man, I'm going to get laid with these you know.
Well, you were 20.
20. This is gonna be great. They probably haven't seen a black guy ever. I'm gonna be.
They certainly haven't seen one like you.
No, they have not seen one like me.
Is what you're thinking.
Yeah, and not as it didn't really pan out quite, like, you know. And when I say blunt, like they're, you know, the women will just, yeah, I do not like your shirt. Nice to meet you. I'm Marika. You know, you're like, wow.
That's their opener.
That's their opener. Is they'll be just very upfront, and they, you know, well, you have to be honest, right? I mean, do you not value honesty?
No, we don't.
You know, no, not
in America.
At all. We are bullshit artists.
That's not specific to just Dutch women. I can tell you,
just
my whole life.
All women in general.
Just women in general are pretty always.
You cannot go to Amsterdam.
They really won't like your shirt.
I'm just saying.
Yeah, but the it was just a different world.
But you certainly went there. A young man and came out a seasoned performer.
Yeah,
is what it sounds like.
Yeah, as everybody that goes there, you know, gets the privilege to do.
Yeah,
and you know, did some great things. You know, the Edinburgh Fringe Festival and
a couple of you or just yourself?
There was about five Edinburgh. Any year would have gotten to go. You know, do that. And I ran a show with a guy named Brendan Hunt, who is just a fantastic improviser. So it was a two-man show that we got to do at the Fringe Festival. At the same time, we were doing this five-man or five-person Boom Chicago show.
Right.
And just, yeah, so many great opportunities. They have this corporate element where they go teach Dutch people how to improvise.
Sure.
Which is kind of like, it's kind of like trying to, you know, count. I have no end of this joke. Sam, you're good at this.
Yep.
Little analogy help.
Counting the possibilities that, you know, of where the joke could go in your head. No. It's a tedious. Yeah, do you have one?
I got nothing for you.
All right,
teaching the Dutch to improvise.
Teaching the Dutch to improvise. It's like trying to pull weeds out of your drive. Nope, I got nothing.
See, it's a tough one. Awful setup.
Yep,
by the way,
sorry.
I love the fact that this is coming out of, so you became a seasoned improviser. But
a little off your game.
Oh my God. You know, that's the other thing about Amsterdam, of course, I smoked a lot of weed.
Uh-huh.
And so now anything I've ever learned is almost gone.
Yeah, well, also there's the last few years has been a focused, a quick body of work for you in terms of less improvising and more writing and more crafting of actual sketches.
Yes.
To be.
I've got actual time to work things out now.
Yeah.
And.
And do you prefer that now? Do you think the writing?
Well,
I mean, have you always been a writer because you've had no choice?
Yeah, with this one, the story probably goes. You know, and so backing up to the swap, the stage swap that we came and we did, performed on the Second City in Chicago's main stage as
right.
Boom Chicago,
right.
They swapped with us. This is where I met Keegan Michael Key. Just, you know, fast forward Mad TV in 2003, I got on Mad TV. That first year, you know, I came, you know, came in top of my game, thinking this is great. You know, I'm gonna do a sketch, and then
everyone's gonna love you.
I'm gonna do, you know, Letterman, and then I'll get the
Academy Award,
and then then we'll see what 2004 brings. I came out there, and it just didn't happen like that. Reality comes, and you realize, okay, there's a whole new piece of this work I've got to do.
Yeah.
And so Mad TV is really what taught me to say, you know what, I got to essentially write myself onto this show. They have great writers and...
But the actors like SNL are encouraged to make a relationship with a writer or write their own stuff.
Or write their own stuff.
There's a story that you actually went to Keegan Michael and said, we've got to do this thing together.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, I don't know if I'm coming back next year, basically.
Yeah, that was exactly, I mean.
And it was the superstitions sketch?
The superstitious, the superstitious basketball players.
Right.
Which some people know as man up, you know, because we had our catchphrase. I'll put all the, basically just a bionic man of a sketch where we put all the pieces together.
Right.
To essentially say, you got to bring me back next year because you want we've got a little something here.
Right.
And really fun to perform. I mean, we, at a time when we just, the table reads, you know, you'd sort of come in, you'd read the sketches that were given to you and see what happens. You know, I was like, all right, Keegan, we got to rehearse this. So that we come into the table read and we perform this whole dance number.
And fuck people up with it.
And fuck people up.
Yeah.
And then they can't not bring me back for the following.
But I like that you realize you had to be proactive to at least attempt a better chance of coming back the next year.
I mean, this was a time, you know, the convention, the rules of a sketch show is there can only be one, you know, light-skinned black dude on a show.
I did not see that in the bylaws.
Or zero. Uh-huh. Either one or zero.
Yeah.
And so, and Keegan and I got there the same year, and this motherfucker is, I mean.
But he was hired as a regular and you were hired as?
No, it wasn't quite. We were both hired as feature, but he got on like a regular.
Immediately.
And he's, you know, he's the, I think he's the best sketch performer I've ever seen. You know, work. He pops.
Yeah,
and
he does pop. His energy is unstoppable.
Ridiculous. Yeah. And so that's probably part of the reason I was starting to sweat.
Sure.
You know, right?
Because there's only one.
And he's also impossible to not like. He's the nicest guy in the world.
Was this the beginning of? Because there's a lot in the dossier about the two of you coming out with the show as biracial and giving a lot of credit to Obama, and we're going to talk a lot about that. But is this initial relationship forged partly by that? I mean, because I know you guys through Becky, I believe, at a dinner had a bromance minute one that went on till late in the hour.
Yes, that was in Chicago during that comedy swap.
Was that at the time? Was part of the big connection the biracial aspect of how you both were raised?
Yeah, there was something about that, and you know, I think we both in our own ways, you know, you use what you've got.
Sure.
You know, and so I think both in our own ways, probably, and not even in a way that I judge negatively, you know, we exploit our race.
Sure. Well, the truth is, everyone's looking for a way to be unique,
yes.
Not just in show business. It used to just be in show business. As a stand-up comedian, it's one of the things. What the fuck is your point of view? Are you going to be unique?
Yeah.
And now, thanks to Facebook, everyone thinks they're fucking unique. And
right.
It's annoying as shit that everyone has a page. Everyone thinks they're someone.
Yeah.
It went from reality TV and the fucking Roman Coliseum of audience sitting at home judging people on Jersey Shore.
Yep.
What happened to Snooki, by the way?
Snooki's still out there.
She's still out there.
She's having another baby.
Yeah, she's got her own show, man.
She just, yet another own show?
Well, it's her and JWoww, is it?
No.
I only know because we used this on the Twitter game last week, so I got to catch up with Snooki. She lost a lot of weight.
Aww.
And is having another baby.
I hate that she felt the pressure to lose weight.
You don't want her to be losing weight and having a baby.
Well,
that's a bad combo.
That's a fun combo.
That's that Rosemary's baby.
There's lots of bad combos.
She had a baby, then lost her weight, and having another baby.
Yeah.
So, you know, so now it's literally everyone's unique and everyone has a page and everybody is somebody. So, you know, it's completely organic.
Mm-hmm.
And my question is specific to that in
yeah.
the sense of, this is what makes me unique.
Mm-hmm.
And now here's another guy that's saying this feeling. This is one of the things that makes him unique as a performer.
Yeah.
Because part of the dossier also that I found wonderful was you sort of always said, quoting you, you always thought of yourself as a African American comedian or a black comedian.
Mm-hmm.
That was part of how you. Your own self-image.
Totally. Yeah. And I think part of that was this idea that in order to especially make it in this business, you have to fit into some an archetype that people can wrap their head around.
And desire.
And proven
ground.
And, you know, stand-ups have you know, the thing that stand-ups get that improvisers, sketch comedians don't get is this thing we're talking about. They hone who they are.
Yeah.
And, you know, my Keegan and my art form is all about being a chameleon. And
playing somebody else.
Playing somebody else. Yeah. And you have done both, of course, in your in your thing. But we
But you're right. It's vastly different.
Yeah, really. And that's why, you know, stand-ups be getting them, you know, sitcoms where you just you know who Ray Romano is. You know his voice.
Yeah, you made the mistake of becoming an actor.
Right. We went the wrong way, and now, you know, of course, now in this show
you went the wrong way, and here you are with your own show. You're right. You went the wrong way.
Well, you know, but that to answer the question, yeah, I mean, Chicago, and the improv and sketch community was really populated with white people. You know,
vastly. Well, you're in Chicago,
and I think, you know, I think a lot of black, you know, comedians might go into stand-up because that's where our heroes are. You know, that's the
prior
legends. Sure. You know, and of course we have, you know, in Living Color sort of stood out as black sketch show. This is great. This is something where, you know, you have African American performers playing all different types.
Yeah, but then even Chappelle driving hard on the race card, if you will, in terms of this is how fucked up everyone's perception is, and I'm going to make you look at it.
Yes.
And one of the interesting things about Key and Peele in a lot of the interviews is that they keep asking what your mandate is, what your you know, goals are, to hold up the mirror to white America. And you guys are pretty straightforward about saying it's a slow process for you creatively to get to the biracial announcement. And as you put it, coming out of the biracial closet, which I thought was great.
Yeah, that.
And what Obama meant to that. But again, it seems like your first mandate is to entertain.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, we love comedy. We love the power of laughter. It's, to me, it's a cathartic thing. You know, all the shows that have inspired me in my life have been transformative. I mean, and part of the identity of sketch to me, if you're gonna have a sketch show, it needs to be something that's boundary pushing. That's all the greats have this sense of they went there,
right?
You know,
yeah. No, SNL planted the flag on that,
right?
For itself.
Well, and
then Mad TV, of course, too. And then the funny thing was, in one of the interviews, you made an interesting observation, which may be a sticking point for a lot of the people who worked on Mad TV, that SNL was its writers were greatly inspired by the writing in Mad Magazine, by this subversive. Right. Comedic point of view from Mad Magazine that so many of those writers, myself too, although I'm slightly younger, but not much than those guys, that what Mad Magazine meant in terms of forming your point of view.
Yeah, and that Mad was big for me too, growing up, and you know, getting onto Mad TV, you know, the first reaction is like, this is awesome. Kind of wish it was SNL. Kind of wish I was on SNL.
Yeah.
But this is awesome because the Mad TV, Mad Magazine was huge to me as a kid.
Yeah.
There's really no connection between the show.
None whatsoever. Was Dick Blasucci still there?
Yes.
I love Dick.
Dick Blasucci is, he's a great, great man. Very funny.
How many years did Mad TV go? 9, 10, 11?
It was on a long time. I'm going to say at least nine seasons, maybe 10.
I think it might have been more.
For
some reason, the number 13.
So even though it's the stepchild, if you will, to SNL, it is the only sketch show of its kind that had any lasting power. Compared to this handful of others, the Friday night.
Well, I mean, in Living Color, it only ran 5 seasons, but those were pretty groundbreaking 5 seasons.
I think
95 to 2009.
95 to 2009.
So 13 or 14
years. Crazy.
Yeah.
And it was. I mean, I think there was their time slot against SNL, so it was. I don't know if it did itself a service or did itself a disservice to have, you know, to basically. It shouted, "We got one too." You know what I mean?
And we're not afraid.
And we're not afraid.
No, I'm sure the lesser rating that they got on a consistent level meant nothing to them, as didn't mean anywhere near as much to them as we're not afraid. We're on a different network. We're going to plant the flag on Saturday night for Fox.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I mean, someone had to do it. Someone had to do it.
What do you go on Friday nights? The worst night for television viewing?
Right.
The options aren't.
And I can't remember, but I think it's possible that In Living Color was also.
I think In Living Color was a Sunday night show.
It's a Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, interesting. But
I feel like it was because I remember watching it with The Simpsons.
Yep, Simpsons, yeah. And also thinking, oh, this is okay, so funny. Well, now I got to finish my homework and go to school.
Yeah, right.
Tomorrow.
And then you'd talk about it at school the next day. Right. But they all have that feeling of this is a response to SNL.
Yeah.
You know, which is, you know, one of the greatest shows of all time.
Right. So now you, getting back to your guys' mandate, mm-hmm. about, you know, the show starting episode one, season one, the evolution of. We want people to tune back in. We're doing something special.
Mm-hmm.
We're doing something original. We, too, are going to push the envelope in our way, mm-hmm. with our point of view.
Right.
And then at one point, do you start to get a little more comfortable with, as you say, coming out of the biracial closet as a comedic point of view?
Well, the whole voice of the show that you're talking about developed as we made the first season.
Highest rated first show since 2009 for Comedy Central.
Yeah, there was something
your
about
your guys'
that.
First episode.
Yeah, I think a big part of that was we came and, you know, we had no idea, of course, that the digital side of this show was going to be such a huge phenomenon. And we came out, first thing we came out was the Obama Luther sketch. And that.
Luther being the voice of anger?
The translator.
Millions of views.
Millions of views, and we knew.
Prior to your debut, it got those?
Yeah.
That was brilliant.
Yeah. And that kind of spoke towards the relevance that there's something going on, I think, to people. It was at a time when I think the conventional wisdom was still there's nothing funny about the president. There's no way to make fun of him. What are they going to do? What is SNL going to do? Because there's no one can really capture the impression. No one knows what's funny about him.
Right.
And so I think we hit that, you know, really kind of a two-man impression.
But I love the observation that you guys made. Elaborate if you can, maybe the genesis of. Was he being heckled by a white senator or something?
Yes.
And he kept his composure, of course, mm-hmm. and it was crystal clear to you guys that in that situation, any president's not allowed to get angry.
Any president.
Him in particular.
Yes. I mean, and he, you know, he had to run on this, you know, he's the most rational human being on the planet. And a lot of that was racial. I think is that, you know, he's walking this tightrope where, you know, he's got just people
waiting.
When's the black shoe gonna drop here? And then, you know, we're coming out of years of Bush, who, you know, of course had this. You know, his persona was, you know.
I'm just a dummy.
I'm just a dummy. And, yeah. And you know, people wanted somebody who was going to bring it all together.
Yeah.
And
let's not forget Oprah told us who to vote for.
And Oprah told us. So that was crystal clear. She helped us out in that way.
I didn't expect her to go door to door the way she did. But, she accomplished what the mafia was never powerful enough to do.
Right.
I mean, only George Sr.
Yeah.
And Kennedy Sr. were able to get their sons elected.
All right.
Oprah's the only other person, I think, singular voice who got someone, well, helped someone.
Yeah, no.
The greatest PR system for any candidate, I
absolutely.
Think, is to find, they're always looking for someone to speak out on their behalf,
mm-hmm.
you know, and it's always a bit of a political soup as to who's going to speak, who should be speaking.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I remember Al Gore, basically they were saying, you know, we're okay.
We're
you don't need to speak for the Democratic nominee this year. You know, well,
there's some.
We know you got elected and you lost. Still,
right.
Yeah, it's just you sound like a vice principal, and no one wants to hear you talk.
Right, right.
And it
Oprah's the Oracle from the Matrix.
It completely and utterly.
Yeah.
I mean, has there been a more powerful voice in this last 25, 30 years in terms of crossing all boundaries? So. Her brilliance of seeing him as a young politician and saying he can be the first black president because
this is the guy, right?
He's so fucking brilliant and he understands not to scare the white folk. Honestly and truly.
Yeah.
It's such an important component. And speaking of Kennedy, very similar fear with you can't get a Catholic anywhere near this White House.
Right.
That can never happen.
Right.
Because we have to get elected by America.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? The Christians hate the Catholics.
Yeah, right.
So this isn't going to happen.
This isn't going to happen. And that's this was, you know, a time where so much was getting thrown at Obama. You know, he's walking this line and there, you know, people are telling him that, you know, he's not from the country and, you know, yelling at him and
his composure was unbelievable.
And he never, you know, addressed it.
So this was this was the genesis. With the two of you together, or one of you just called the other and said, oh, fuck, wait?
Well, you know, we knew we wanted to do something with the president.
Because you had this
impression. I had the impression, and we knew we wanted to do, it was one of these things where we had all the ingredients, and it was just kind of shuffling around, and then we know, you know, Keegan's real specialty is popping
anger
and you know, being able to portray anger and being
the angry zombie was one of my
favorite. Okay. The extra. That's great. Yeah. And did you see the episode or did you see it online?
No, I saw the episode.
Yeah. The story.
Does it go deeper online?
No. The episode we introduced the whole idea, this, you know, that there was this background performer that one day when I was doing the Obama ATM scene, who we just said, you know, respond to the president like you would respond, and his improv was, oh, what's up, Obama baby? And it was just like, we're in the editing room, just like, wait, rewind it again, this is amazing. And so, yeah, that whole sketch was based on that moment, and I think...
But now he's a zombie extra.
Now we put it in, like, sort of Walking Dead world, yeah. Mm-hmm. That...
So he's going to be the anger for Obama in the sketch. And
so, yeah, so we figured out what... Let's take what Keegan does, let's take what I do. The differences in the energy, and it was some eureka moment.
It was.
We were just discussing.
It really was lightning in a bottle.
Yeah.
And also, a good point as a way to let people know which one of you is going to focus on what, which one of you is, what your different talents
are. What our different things
while you co-star in this new launch.
One of the rules or things that we gave ourselves, because like I said, I think in the beginning, not being stand-ups, the real question is, what's the voice of this show?
And how do we identify ourselves as the stars of the show? Which I think it's great that you come out in the beginning and you talk to the audience.
Yep.
Let's get an idea of your energy together, your relationship, your instant chemistry.
Totally.
Yeah.
But we also knew it has to have a different voice than the Chappelle show.
Mm.
People...
Well, that's what I'm saying about his, you know, genius. A lot of it was sort of anger-fueled and stupidity.
And it was, it's a perfect show. It's people's favorite thing of all time. Ours, you know, huge influence to us. But we knew coming out, you see a black sketch show, people are going to go, oh, see, they're going to try and be Chappelle up in here.
Mm-hmm.
Going to try and be Chappelle up. You ain't Chappelle. And you're right. We're,
so you wanted them, everyone to know that you wanted to own that first.
So we had to, if another, just like the Mad TV, if we're going to get this next year, it's going to be because we can deliver something that can't be replaced. And so we had to figure out how to do that. So one of the ways we figured out how to do that was to say with the sketches, all right, what are sketches that only Keegan and I can pull off? Whether it's because we're the only performers that can rock those characters in that way, or if, because it's a racial angle that no one else on TV can get up on an auction block and, you know, do make, you know, essentially find laughs in a slavery scene. Uh-huh. You know, whatever it was, whatever
the drug deal at the car, was it like one of those rest stops along the highway or something?
Let's see. Are you talking about not the poop your pants scene?
No, he's giving you the cash. The wrong. Or you, one of you doesn't know how to do the drug deal.
We've played a lot of drug dealers. Oh,
hand me the money and don't look like you're handing me the money. That.
Oh yeah. The that yes, that's the bit is the guy who's trying to be subtle.
Right.
In the drug deal, and the drug dealer saying, "Don't come on, man. Just hand it to me." Being subtle looks like you're doing a drug deal, man.
Right.
Just give me the money and put some flourishes on it, and sell it to the cheap seats, so they don't think anything's happening. You know,
right.
Just yeah, that. But yeah, there's just about, especially in that first season, just right. About every sketch has some element of we thought. Only we could pull this off. Only we would try to pull this off.
And because it makes you laugh first, do you think?
A lot of the time, you know, we write a ton of sketches.
Right.
And they all make us laugh. But yeah, there was a couple that are in the category of this we can only do this because we're the only ones that would dare to do this. I mean, one of our, you know, not necessarily our most successful scene, but one of my favorites is Bobby McFerrin versus Michael Winslow, which is basically like, it's basically the Roadrunner, Wile E. Coyote done with the Kings of Mouth Noise. And it's like, this sketch is so stupid, but there's an elegance in the fact that it's nonverbal.
Right.
And it has a classic comedic feel,
yeah.
And the references are so specific. They're from, you know, they're this late '80s, early '90s period, and really, it's like it's one of these sketches. I know it's like if you know who these guys are.
But that's the comedy lightning in the bottle again. The fact that you paired these two against each other when it's in everyone's subconscious to know. Oh, of course. It's an instant, of course,
yeah.
That these two noisemakers,
yeah.
One musically and one comedically,
mm-hmm.
Should have a throwdown.
Yeah, and I think the my favorite, and this was a scene that I had been trying, this is actually a good example of, you know, the difference between Mad TV and our show. That was a scene I was trying to get Mad TV to let us do, but, you know,
whatever.
Way too obscure,
right.
Way too... you know, I guess artistic in its vision somehow,
mm-hmm.
To, you know, it just wouldn't have worked on that show. And it wouldn't right. Have worked for the fan base at the time. You know, fan base, they had very clear voice of that show set up. And so, you know, now all of a sudden we have our own show and I'm like, dude, it's time to do this sketch.
Yeah.
And my favorite thing about it is this idea that is the mythology that we invent that somehow because they're both doing the same thing, but Michael Winslow is like light and sort of easygoing in, you know, let's just say Bobby McFerrin has a heap of integrity. Let's put it that way. I love Michael Winslow. But, you know, so we wanted to take McFerrin and make him the...
Comedian could technically be considered a clown.
Yes.
Whereas a musical artist
there it is.
Is Einstein.
Well put. And so we put this sort of like Mozart-Salieri relationship.
Right.
Like you're sullying my craft. You know, on McFerrin's part. And then, of course, Winslow is getting the huge... That's the real mythology, that Winslow's wildly more successful than Bobby McFerrin. You know, who's, of course, selling out concert venues in real life and has his Grammys and Grammys and Grammys.
Yeah.
But
doesn't want anyone to really point out that he's making noises.
Right.
Also.
He doesn't want, he does not want to be associated with Michael Winslow.
I've got it.
Please.
Okay.
Trying to teach improv to the Dutch is trying to teach proper dental hygiene to the British.
Yes!
Scene!
That is it. That's
Thanks for bringing it home,
for.
Sammy.
Thank you.
Oh, not sure why Jesus. It took 24 minutes, but thank you.
That is the most patient repartee of all time.
I'm gonna truly patient. I'm gonna tease two bits and then go to the sponsor. Yeah. As to why you should not look away, I want to discuss your great quote, Obama is the coolest thing to ever happen to black nerds. Before him, we had Urkel and Lamar from Revenge of the Nerds. And I want Jamie to help me with my question, which is, what about Larry Fishburne's postman character in Pee-wee's Playhouse?
It was a Cowboy Curtis, actually. Curtis.
Wouldn't he fit right into the Urkel and Lamar?
He had a little swagger,
Come
though.
Come on.
He was sexy.
He was right in there.
Yeah.
And also... the first time you noticed Clinton was the first president you guys both talked about noticing. I'm talking to white people voice versus I'm talking to black people voice.
Right.
That's a rich subject I would love to discuss right after this word from our sponsor, Pro Flowers. How are you going to order Mother's Day flowers, people? I know what I'm doing tomorrow. I am contacting proflowers.com. Thank your mom for putting up with all your shenanigans with one dozen rainbow roses with a free glass vase. Do you say vase or vase, Sammy?
I typically say vase.
Because you're less pretentious.
Yep.
Vase seems pretentious.
I think it's probably a regional thing.
Regional?
Why not?
Californian, say vase. From proflowers.com for just $19.99, you're going to get yourself that rainbow does. Go bigger, double the color pro roses, plus free glass, vase, and chocolates for just $9.99 more. Use my code CHAT. That's my very own private personal code that I'm going to share with you, CHAT, C-H-A-T, to get this special Mother's Day deal. Order now while supplies last. Pro flowers are guaranteed to last a full week or your money back. How about that? I've never heard of that from a flower.
I've never heard of that.
How do I get my flowers to last a week, you may ask?
I do ask.
Order from Pro Flowers and find out. Freshly picked bouquets, perfect for Mother's Day. Ordering is easy. Pick your delivery date and it's guaranteed. Here's the only way to get this amazing Mother's Day deal. Go to proflowers.com, click on the blue microphone in the top right-hand corner and type in chat. That's proflowers.com. Click the blue mic, type in chat. The deal expires midnight Friday. Make sure you order today. Thank you, Pro Flowers. And thank you, folks, who've been saying you want to support this show. Now you know how. Don't use any other flower.com or I'll find you. So it didn't dawn on me in the moment I read it in the research of noticing that Clinton had a way to talk to a white audience and... And then he had a wonderful, and it might just be a Southern thing.
It's probably a Southern thing.
Right.
I mean, he is our first biracial president as well.
Technically speaking. Yeah.
He had it. And I actually met Clinton when I was a kid. I did this thing called Kids Ask President Clinton Questions.
Oh, you didn't just do the Ask President Clinton Questions, but... was Peter Jennings Canadian? Why is my memory that Peter Jennings was a fucking Canuck? That fucking Canadian prick tried to squash you raising your hand to ask a question. These kids have been gathered to ask President Clinton anything.
Yeah.
Peter Jennings was the host. Towards the end of it, his hand goes up.
My hand goes up. And
Clinton sees it.
Clinton sees it. He goes.
And Jennings says, "We're about at a time."
Rest his soul. And Clinton goes, "No, Jordan. Yeah. Jordan." And then of course I had forgotten I had a name tag on, so I was kind of frozen in a moment of glee and delight. And then I, you know, I asked my question, but yes, I had this moment where
what
I felt
was your
like
question? Do you remember?
My question was, how is there anything, and it's very telling, is what can you do if there's a household, a single parent household, where one of the parents does not pay child support, or you know, that kind of thing. It was very,
how can you help single parents?
How can you help single parents? You know, in little kids' voice.
How old are you?
11.
Spectacular.
Something like that.
Did anyone help you with this question? That's pretty great.
No, I mean,
you
it
just
was
get right in the president of the United States' face.
I got right
and
in
say,
it.
Say. My mom's raising me on her own.
Yeah.
And I want to know what you can do for her.
What you can do. And he really, you know, yeah, I don't think he was expecting.
But that's what Clinton loves.
Yeah. And he.
He is the master at
he
please
is.
Challenge me.
Yeah.
Because I will not let you down.
Yeah, that's right.
And did he come through?
And he, yeah, he came through. I mean, it was a very politician, right. You know, and I was answer in that, you know, a long version. Of the answer of
I'll do everything I can.
Yeah, not much. Really, there's not much I can do.
Yeah, my hands are tied.
My hands are tied.
Literally.
Do I know your mom? You know.
And you said probably not. She's white.
She's white. And of course, I at that time, you know, I was sweating bullets to, you know, I come all this way. I wanted to get my question in. So the second I got my question out, I probably just kind of shut down. And,
yeah.
You know, it
yeah.
was
TV time.
It was TV time, and
And did you meet him years later and regale this experience?
No, I haven't met him since.
Funny you say that because we've got him here.
What?
Bringing forward
you
president.
Waited all this time to bring him? How am I the guest?
We're an hour into the interview, and I can't believe we held out as long as we did, hoping you would mention it.
You have quite the pattern, then, of hanging with the presidents,
I've got
don't
a couple
you?
Presidents.
Yeah.
Obama loves you guys.
Let's Obama's a fan, yeah.
Come on.
I think.
And it was a fan of that first sketch.
Fan of the first sketch, which is crazy, because that to me, that basically, for him to endorse that publicly is basically like him saying, "Yep, that's right. Thank you, because that is exactly what I wish I could say, and you nailed it. You know, so to us, basically, he made with that endorsement, he made Luther. Real. He said, yes, Luther is an anger translator.
Deep inside me.
Deep inside. And you know, I mean, because, yeah, he's so.
Which, by the way, is so brilliant as a politician also, to humanize himself.
Yeah.
God forbid I should suggest that all politicians, if not all humans, have their own agenda.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and he's got, you
But
know,
he didn't need to do that. He could have kept that private. He could have just told his friends, I love this sketch. The fact that he came out was pretty great.
Absolutely. Well, you know, it was also probably something strategic about it, too.
Yeah.
Or definitely. I mean,
yeah.
I don't know if anything he does is going to not be strategic. But it was during the election year. And he needed.
Re-election, more
the re-election year.
Yeah.
And he needed the young people to come out again.
Yeah.
And I think that there was something about our show that he knew was
golden ticket for him. Mm-hmm. And how crazy is that? That you've tapped into
crazy.
Pop culture instantly by the President of the United States reaching out and saying, you guys make me laugh.
I want to, these guys make me look cool. Yeah. Look a little cooler, which of course is, you know, it's not, is ironic, and it's not hard, but it's, you know, it really is the other way around. I mean,
yeah.
He, and this kind of, you touched on this before, but, you know, I was saying like, there, you know, for guys like Keegan and I, who are, you know, sort of ethnic melting pots, we are code switching masters, we're character actors, but there wasn't a real place or an archetype that we would really fit into.
Yeah.
You know, there's, you know, you got
African Americans in general
right.
thought they were getting a leg up when he was elected.
Yes.
But as a biracial American, you've got to think.
It was different. And
huzzah!
Dude, all of a
he's
sudden.
He's not your president. He's my president.
He's my president.
You don't understand the true connection now.
All of a sudden, there's this guy.
Because before that, you had what? Lenny Kravitz?
I mean, Lenny Kravitz is the only cool version.
Right?
Of a, yeah. And I mean, that's where the Urkel. Lamar from Nerds thing comes. I mean, really.
There's another great one. Raised by your mother, Caucasian, you've said that it was the existence of Webster and Different Strokes that made, yeah, sometimes a white lady has a black baby more acceptable.
Right.
It's always fucking something. Beautiful.
I don't remember that one, but yeah. Yeah, those are the type of shows that gave me a little, you know,
yeah,
something to be able to tell the other kids in school. Yeah, my mom's white.
Have you not seen
Mrs. Papadopoulos and how they have raised young Webster? You know,
you may not like the spelling of different in Different Strokes, but
yeah, that's right. And so this. Obama ultimately, you know, helped give us relevance, mm-hmm, and a.
It became a cultural.
It became something we could say. All right, well, this is just a truth. And the reason we always say, you know, felt like we were coming out as biracial was, I think, more than anything, you know, hey, as black performers, we knew we could count on having African American audiences relate to us and be on our side and want us to succeed.
Right.
And so coming out of the gate with that on that first show and saying we're biracial, to me the fear is, what is there a message that is being sent that's saying, you know, you assumed we're black but we're not, and does that, you know, does that message ultimately take away some of that relation for us with this fan base that we were, you know, counting on and hoping that would accept us.
But what a, A, pushing the envelope, B, taking a chance that you have to in sketch, as we spoke earlier, but also personally, there's an empowerment of, we have found our voice.
Yeah.
And this is a voice that's not been represented.
This is something that only we can do right now.
Yeah.
And
how exciting.
So exciting. And I think that, you know, the lessons of Del Close, of Second City and Improv Olympic, is truth and comedy. You know, he and Sharna Halpern wrote this book, Truth and Comedy. And that was my first Bible of improv.
Yeah.
And, you know, that there's nothing more that continues to resonate more than this idea of, when you're talking about comedy, people can smell bullshit. Mm-hmm. People know if you're being genuine, and people need their comedians. They need to trust their comedians.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
And the moment you get a sense, oh, they're doing that because the network wants them to do that. They're doing that.
They don't believe what they're saying.
Or they don't believe what they're saying. You can't go on and then trust them when they're taking on slavery or taking on some topic that is taboo or really, really anything.
Yeah.
You want to know that they're shooting it to you straight.
Right, but also I would think finding your voice. There's only one way to do that. You have to have the courage to listen to it and then speak it.
Yeah. I mean, anyone who...
You'll never get there without it.
Yeah. And any comedian that has had some sort of success and done, you know, good things, I think has zoned in on either their persona and who they're, you know, who they are, you know, even if it's something of a put-on character,
right,
a truth that the audience can understand about that person and come to expect, and a voice, mm-hmm, that is coming from a place of truth, even if it's put on in a way.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know. I'll have to think about that more.
This is a perfect opportunity, by the way, for you to enjoy a part of this show that for the second week in a row has been specifically designed for you and to you. Mm-hmm. One of the games we play on the show.
Oh.
I noticed that you're on the Twitter.
I am on the Twitter.
I follow you. It's a game we play that Sam is going to host, a little competition competition between the guest and myself, and it's called Who Tweeted?
Who Tweeted? I've heard of this.
Count the tweets.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Celebrities have so much to say. We got to fix that graphic.
Is that the same caricature artist?
Yeah, that's the same caricature artist. It is. He hangs out in Venice Beach. It's fine. Don't worry. Right. Okay, so this is Who Tweeted? South Park, Colbert, Tosh Edition.
Ah!
All Comedy Central
teams. Well, okay. Well,
all the voices of Comedy Central.
The
have
icons
come,
of Comedy
the
Central.
The icons of Comedy Central have come to play in this week's Who Tweeted.
Okay.
So here's how the game works. One at a time, I will read a series of 8 tweets, all of which were authored by either South Park, Colbert, or Tosh. At any point that you feel you know who authored that tweet, you ring in by saying your own name. Then I'll point to you. You have 3 seconds to say either South Park, Colbert, Tosh.
Okay.
Ring in, you get it right, you get 5 points. Ring in, you get it wrong, you lose 3.
There's a penalty for a
that's
wrong
right.
answer.
Okay. Once someone rings in, they either get it or they don't, and we move on. There are no second chances. And at the end of 8 tweets, the winner will be walking away with this. Andy J.
Okay. Illuminati in the house here.
That's right. Right. That's right. You're inspecting the belt.
It is. It took 202 shows for someone to remind us that Andrew Jackson was, in fact, a part of the Illuminati.
All right.
I've seen my Nicolas Cage movies. All right.
Yes.
Are you ready to play Who Tweeted South Park Colbert Tosh Edition?
Aunt Jordan, yes, I am.
Perfect.
That's one point.
Here we go. Tweet number one. A study found that popular kids are more likely to be bullied. Makes sense. Even bullies don't want to be caught hanging around losers.
It's going to be Tosh.
Ooh, I'm sorry, no. I may have delivered it like Tosh, but it was actually Colbert.
That's what did it.
That's what did it. I'll throw you off.
The same sing-songy delivery for each
Each one.
Three.
Yeah, that's all right. Learning curve.
Early,
learning easy.
Curve.
Easy to come back
now,
from that.
Now, since he got 1 point for ringing in correctly on yes, that's only a negative.
Only a negative two? Okay, noted. Noted.
And
tweet.
Also, thank you, Jamie, for finding these.
Absolutely. There's some good ones in here. Tweet number two. Can't we just pay the Chinese an extra nickel or
Kevin,
something?
South Park.
Oh, sorry, no.
All right.
Yeah, I was with you, though. I was with you, though. They had me a Chinese.
It's actually a pretty funny tweet. I'm going to read it all.
Read it.
Can't we just pay the Chinese an extra nickel or something to write Made in USA on everything?
Oh, that's Colbert.
And it was Tosh, actually.
Tosh. So is that a double?
Wow, you're going deep cut.
No, he just gets the one wrong, and that's that. No second guesses.
No,
I wish I could dock him twice. I do. I do. It's all right. It's all right. It's a neck and neck game at -2 to -3. Tweet number three. Where is Portugal anyway? Is it in Spain? Is it near Mexico? No one knows.
Aunt Jordan, South Park.
Oh, sorry, no.
We suck at this. This
is a really tough one.
Okay.
I would not do well at this.
Colbert.
Tosh.
What? Who knew?
Who knew?
I thought he was a tool.
Yeah.
He's coming off
He's
very intelligent.
He's got some very good writers.
I don't mind Tosh.
I was kidding. Okay, -5 to -3. I'm crushing this game.
Really?
3 wrong answers.
You know what? We're not going to have an incident like... We're not even going to talk about
like before.
Basically, it's guesswork. There's really nothing to base
hold on to.
I'll just say this. You guys have been guessing a specific one that hasn't come up yet. So sooner or later. Tweet number four. Excuse me, is this where Earth Day crap is happening?
Jordan. That's South Park.
That is correct.
That is South Park.
That is correct. Simply by default.
Yes.
Really.
Well,
and you
right.
just picked up. Somewhere.
You just picked up the 5 points you were negative.
Back at 0.
You're
all
back
right.
at 0.
All right. breaking even. I'm happy about this.
I'm still in the hole.
Still in the hole.
Here I come.
Get back in the hole. Tweet number 5. I've experienced affirmative action firsthand. I applied for president in 2008, and they gave it
Kevin
to some black guy.
Colbert.
That is correct.
Yep. Not fair.
Yep. Yep. Well done. Well done.
You got to ring in fast on
that one. That one had clues in it.
It did.
That one.
A couple of clues.
Had clues.
First one. Easier. First out of 4. All right.
It's all right. Tweet number 6.
Is it?
Yep.
Okay.
Shatner.
Bonus point.
Bonus point.
Bonus point.
He's +1.
+1 to +2. Tweet number 6. What's going on in the Lakers game? I don't have ESPN Classic.
That's pretty great. That's actually very funny.
Jordan. Tosh.
Yes!
All right.
Well done. Anyone who's ever seen his show knows what a big basketball fan he is.
All right.
+6 to +2.
Oh, it's a, we got a real barn burner, boys.
It's a squeaker now.
Here we go.
Excited. Tweet number 7, getting down to the wire. Funky Town is a classic disco song by the band Lips Incorporated.
Thanks for that information. Kevin, South Park.
That is correct.
Woo! Well done, well done.
This is, as they say, where it all comes down to.
Seven to six.
7-6, okay.
These are exciting games.
Even so, a ring in and a wrong answer from you gives the game to Jordan.
Yes.
A ring in and a right answer from either of you takes the game. This is
okay.
The 8th.
He's responding this way genuinely, even though he doesn't seem genuine.
Yeah, it is.
Because it's a little disingenuous,
I want,
right?
I want you to win.
All right, I'll take it.
The 8th and final tweet. I'm not racist. Some of my favorite history months are black.
Jordan. Colbert.
That is correct!
Oh!
Nicely done, sir.
It was
your winner.
It was a tough one.
We were both hunkered down into not committing to a guess.
The difference between Tosh and Colbert is a little bit of taste.
It's
a little bit of taste.
We have a victor.
That is how you play. Who
Thank you.
Tweeted.
And
enjoy.
There it
Congratulations.
Is.
Congratulations. Nice job.
It's a new. It's one of the new ones where
it's
they got the
gift
big head.
Bag and a big head, Andrew Jackson.
All right. I'll use this to get home.
That's right. That's right. Nicely done. Thank you, Sammy.
Thank
and
you.
Thank you, Jamie.
Yes. For... Well conceived. Well executed.
Let's talk about the. Because I think we hinted. I teased it, and then we talked around it, but the president talking with the white voice versus black, and then, because it really gets stepped up now with Obama.
Yeah.
Because you guys have commented, you have before in an interview, about that you noticed a sense of he's among friends, or even though... Because of the presidential persona, because of the political persona, he's never been allowed to, for lack of a better term, let his hair down. So how funny is that to you, or how engaging or endearing is that to you to see him in front of a black audience?
Oh, I mean, it's fucking hilarious. It's it's like the best thing to me. And by the way, he kind of acknowledged this in a subtle way. You know, he said, you know, also not just the Luther thing. I love the phone call sketch, and I don't know if you've seen this one. The phone call sketch is one where Keegan's on a street corner and he's talking to his wife about the theater, and he, you know, speaking just in this very sort of white manner. And then I come up next to him on the street, and I'm also on the phone. And Keegan starts going, you know, all right, I'll meet you at the theater at like 8 o'clock, you know. And I'm you know, I'm just doing my thing too, and just like, you know, turning. And then of course I walk away and go, Christian, I almost totally just got mugged right now. And this was one of the first things. And Obama said, you know, that's one of my favorite. That was good. So I think
it touched the place.
He touched it. You know, that the code switching thing, I think he related to that.
Yeah.
And yeah, you know, if you ever see him, I think there's a vine out there somewhere that sort of puts it perfectly. You see him walk down a line of people and he shakes a white guy's hand and he shakes another white guy's hand and then it comes up, he brings it in for a brother. And it's like, it's instinctual. It's this instinctive
but
thing.
But do you think he feels a connection or do you think he's performing?
I think it is something.
Because it could be both.
I think it's really, I think it's a connection. I think it is
so great.
Yeah, it's something I have.
It's instinctual. I don't even think it's a conscious decision to do it.
Totally. Yeah.
By the way.
And white people do it too.
Yeah, I was just saying, no real difference.
Yeah.
Was it Carlin or Pryor who talked about, I think it was Carlin who talked about, put a white guy in a room.
Yeah.
With a handful.
A bunch of brothers.
A handful.
And he's going to start calling them brothers.
Give him 45 minutes, and he's talking exactly like that.
Oh, my God.
And the opposite is not true.
The opposite is not true. Yeah. That is right. That is right.
But I sense from everything you've said that you did not have a cultural upbringing and experience, and maybe financially, I don't know, that creates a connection, not financially in the sense that you were living in a castle, but what schools you attended and the population.
We just growing up in Miami, you can tell from the question I asked Clinton, we were not well off at all. We had, rent stabilized apartment, Upper West Side, but like you're saying, very rich in fact that I grew up in New York that has exposure to so many different types of people, has great schools, I did go to just a very a public school that was very just a complete melting pot,
but not heavily populated by any one side.
No, it was a wash.
Because you've commented of your own natural voice from when you were young to the present.
Mm-hmm.
I want to find the exact quote because it made me laugh so fucking hard.
Is it that I sound like Pryor doing a white guy?
It's similar because Pryor was the first in our lifetime to make this, but you actually likened it to a Def Jam.
A Def Jam,
Booing a
Caucasian. Doing a white guy voice, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And that you recognize that in your own voice.
Yeah, and it's, by the way, it's a source of so much insecurity.
But where does that come from? That's just the way it goes? It doesn't matter where you're from or who you are, you're going to be a product of your environment, do you think?
Or
we're all just snowflakes, unique and original?
I think snowflake, interesting choice of words. I think
they're all different.
They're all different.
I don't
in
look
that.
At snowflakes as color.
Right.
I look at them as unique.
absolutely. And I think one of my theories is that it's you talk like your mother. You talk.
We all, as infants, learn to speak by mimicking sounds.
By mimicking
sounds.
That's
absolutely 100% true.
Yeah.
And those of us who do impressions never lost that ear. But the truth, I've commented obnoxiously about, this is an absolute fact. Mm-hmm. So boy, does that make sense.
Yeah. And my father wasn't around, so I didn't have his
and it's the voice of reason, it's the voice of the universe.
Yeah,
it's all of that.
Yeah. And then there was a period when I was third grade where I noticed the other students, white, black, Latino, everything in my school, people start putting on the urban dialect, because that there was a coolness to that.
And they're trying to find an identity.
People trying to find an identity.
And you're inspired by people that, like you were saying, heroes.
And this is.
And even if the hero's the kid on the block, we all had somebody that grew up around us that we aspired to be.
Yeah. And, I got, the Jewish kids
sure.
are starting to become blacker than I am at a certain point at this at the school. I'm just like, nah, bullshit.
You ain't, so when you, you hear ain't, the you Beastie, ain't a Beastie Boys, boy.
That's right. And so I think there's.
What's amazing about that, by the way, forgive me for interrupting, is the Beastie Boys seem absolutely authentic in. This is the sound we grew up with, mm-hmm. we aspired to.
Yeah.
This is the sound that we find musical mm-hmm. that has power and resonance to us.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you speak.
Because you talk about being truthful in whatever, whether it's comedy, whatever art you're putting out.
And yeah.
They couldn't sound more truthful.
That's right. And they've pulled off what, you know, of course, you know, so many, you know, white kids across the country have tried to pull off. Since
I think we can count them on one hand for sure, but
right.
you've got
your M&M's.
Your M&M is
you got your M&M's. You got your.
Does iced tea count?
Iced tea.
But he's OG, as they say.
He's OG. He's the real deal.
I've known him forever, and we did a movie together.
God,
I love him so much. Yeah. But what about Vanilla Ice? What about Vanilla Ice?
Vanilla Ice pulled it off for about a second.
He pulled it off for a minute.
Because and his then really wasn't from. More of a cultural thing as much as it was a...
By the way, second Vanilla Ice reference in this
episode. That's true.
Episode. But music, so well, anyways.
Rob Van Winkle
so your influences are your mother and your influences
and then
in influences comedy.
And who you like. And then, of course, I'm a nerd. So I'm, you know, I wasn't early on to hip hop. I fell in love with it a little bit later, you know, in the sort of late in high school, early in college.
What's the first music that you're attracted to?
Oh, like fucking Disney musicals
sure.
and shit.
Sure.
I was, you know, my mother took me to see Showboat and Seven Brides for Seven Brothers at like Revival Theaters when I was growing up. And so right. that was my first love. And then I, fantasy movies and
sure.
shit like
and
that.
And comedy?
And comedy, you know, I Saturday Night Live and Living Color, and Living Color was this, you know, place where, Living Color was huge for me because I was the first place I saw black performers performing a variety of black characters,
and talking about the human experience.
And talking about the human experience
yeah.
and just showing that, you know, black culture is not a monolith, you know, something we say a lot at the show as part of the voice of the show. But, you know, there's this sort of idea growing up that, you know, there's a token black character for anything. Mm. Token like J.R.R. Token, there's no black characters in
the
No,
more
Hobbit.
Like South Park, where they literally named the character.
Where they named the character Token, which is great satire on this thing. But, you know, there's this feeling of, in Living Color, where it's like, oh no, we're gonna have a token white dude on this show. And it was an exploration in the fact that, like, we have six black sketch performers who are all bringing something unique and who are all absolutely hilarious,
yeah.
And that was a huge thing, yeah, for me growing up. And then, you know, yeah, I watched a lot of stand-up as well, and comedy was one of my biggest influences. But the interesting thing, that's such a vague thing to say, comedy is one of my biggest influences. Interesting thing is, since I've been doing it now, it's hard for me to sit down and watch a comedy.
You know too much.
Yeah. You know how the sausage is made.
If it
settle down, Sam.
if it sucks, I can't enjoy it. If it's great, I'm jealous and right. I'm working to say, okay, why didn't I think of that first? Or
tomorrow you begin production on season. 4A? Yeah. You're going to do 20.
Oh, really?
20. Mm-hmm.
So it's like that Comedy Central.
It's like that.
Ugh.
Well, no, it's all a good thing. We're doing 20 episodes, or 22. We have two best of, mm-hmm. possibly a best of, and a sort of worst of, an unreleased episode, possible.
Oh, the lost sketches.
Nice. Which I think will be really fun. You know. Chappelle did something like that, and that was one of my favorites too, because you get to see the factory. But there, ultimately, we're going to do 11, and then there's going to be a little break, and then there's going to be 11, and I think
for the airing. But what about the workflow?
We're working from tomorrow
till the end of time.
Till the end of time, February.
And what is the schedule to make a show? Do you just bank episodes and then decide how to cut them up?
Yeah, we make the sketches, and we edit the sketches, and then we will put together what should be the episodes based on how the sketches turned out.
So you have a team, and you guys write the sketches without a form of the show when it comes to the creation of these sketches.
Exactly. And then Keegan, myself, and the two showrunners, Jay Martell, Ian Roberts, and Peter Atencio, the director, will sit, and there's a lot of, oh, no, look, we can't have two drug dealer scenes in the same episode. Oh, no, this one has two musical pieces, so let's switch this. Oh, this is one of our favorite sketches. Let's put this up early in the season. Mm-hmm. This one is great, but it needs to be earned by the rest of the season, so let's put this at the end. And then we come up with the episodes, and then we shoot the live portions.
Right. And how often do you shoot the live?
We do those in really a couple of weeks' time. We'll have an audience at the Nate Holden Theater, and we shoot two episodes worth of audience reaction, and we show the audience the clips, and it's you know, one of the big discussions early in the formation of the show was, do we use the audience laughter behind the sketches or not? And it was a really tricky, difficult one, because we ended
make an argument for both.
I mean, laughter is contagious.
And it's also genuine and real and organic to what the people watching the actual stuff.
That's
you didn't
right.
buy yourselves some laughter.
Yeah. And there's something about, you know, the way these, you know, sitcoms, these huge sitcoms have always used the fact that, you know, end of a day of work, you want to sit down, you want to relax, you don't want to have to find the comedy in anything. You want to hear the laughter go, oh, I missed that joke. You know. Of course, being able to rewind is new. But yeah, our show is, so much of our show is consumed online. And so that's such a big piece of what's kind of become a phenomenon of Key & Peele, is that we're straddling this thing. We're straddling the television and the online, and I think the fact that we don't have the laughter has made it very suitable for the internet,
right?
And sharing, and that personal experience you have when you're watching a clip on your phone, and not having this disembodied audience between mm-hmm. the things. And then another thing is, like I said, we didn't want to look like we were trying to do the Chappelle show. So any distinction we could find, to us, that was going to help us establish an identity.
Also, it's a nice way to break it up, because when the audience is in front of the two of you and you're talking to them, if we don't hear them laughing as they sit in front of you, that's odd.
Right.
But if we do hear that, and mm-hmm. then we go to the sketches and we don't hear that, mm-hmm. that connection makes sense.
Yeah.
Just as much.
Yeah, but that
the audience wasn't in that warehouse when you shot that scene.
Right.
Yeah. So they don't need to know that you play it back in front of them, because that no longer makes sense to them.
But by the way, that was the scariest part, is, you know, our thinking at a certain point, or we questioned that and thought, on one hand, what you're saying is true, but then on the other hand, we were feeling like, does the, just, and from a pure energy standpoint, do you go from this laughter of the live and then you go into this vacuum where there is no laughter, and does that affect you subconsciously and say, reduce, this isn't funny though.
Right.
This isn't, then all of a sudden they're not getting the laugh. Thankfully.
In your case though, what sets your sketch show apart is that it's, sometimes the laughs are come from something so small, mm-hmm. from a reaction or a non-reaction, or a pause or a beat, and a laugh track on that simply would not work. You'd miss it.
Yeah.
If there were a laugh track going, it just wouldn't play the same. So you guys definitely made the right call.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, there's no question.
We have, you know...
There's a laugh track on this, by the way.
Is there?
I don't know if you knew that.
Yeah, they're adding it out there.
I don't always tell the guests.
Oh, that is
if you may have wondered sometimes why I've sort of paused.
That's what it was. Mm-hmm. You were just cueing a big... guffaw.
Yeah, they know that when I don't speak, I want laughs mm-hmm. punched.
Yeah, we have. I love The Office, you know, both the American and the British. But when the British came out, that was kind of revelatory mm-hmm. in its use of the awkward silence. And those, you realize there's this whole world of laughs we haven't even been trying to get before that show.
Yeah.
And I think that was a big influence, just exactly what you're saying. There's small things. There's uncomfortable silences. Silence can be really funny. And
also, the similarity in terms of you guys now trying to utilize the power of your own experiences mm-hmm. in the comedy of the show can be said of the original Office for Ricky Gervais, mm-hmm. writing what you know. Doing a show about a world he personally experienced.
Yeah.
And showing it up in a light that hadn't been seen before.
Yeah.
There's
a
similarity there. Comedy can be reduced to just that.
Yeah.
The truth of your own experience, now it's on you to execute it in a way that makes it relatable.
Yeah. And there's something about the way so many people find our show online.
Yeah.
That, you know, having been on Mad TV, you know, there's this real difference when people come up and to us now, and they're like, "Oh my God!" And they'll always usually tell us, "Yo, I found the football sketch. I sent this to my friend." They'll describe to us this their sharing of a sketch, and so you realize like there's a personal thing that's happening where people feel like they're a part of telling the joke that we're telling to the friend that they shared it to.
That's right.
And there's something about having that laughter in that would mess that up somehow.
Right.
You know?
Well, that's a big part of comedy and music, maybe all forms of entertainment, is the joy of turning somebody on to it.
Yeah, yeah. You get that little piece of ownership, definitely music.
Yeah. Proprietary is an interesting word when it's used by civilians.
And there's also that thing of...
To describe.
Yeah. There's also that thing in music of, yes. Oh yeah, Red Hot Chili Peppers. I had them on the EP, the first. I was onto them, you know, before they were, you know, there's that whole thing. And, you know, then there's also like, same thing with movies, you know, there's...
If you can't speak,
you know,
Pulp Fiction.
Yeah.
What fucking good are you to me?
Right, and the idea of...
And their ability to quote The Simpsons or Seinfeld, that seems to be a fairly new, within the last 10 to 15 years, phenomenon that didn't exist when I was in my 20s. We were quoting bits from a movie, mm-hmm. or we were quoting a line from a TV show.
Mm-hmm.
But there was no show that lasted 9-10 seasons where you could just speak to each other in quotes from that show. Mm. That's a fairly new phenomenon, I promise.
Well, and I keep it, we keep it like seasons, what, like 3 through eight, maybe.
I usually do like 2 through 10. Yeah.
These guys are special. That sounds like that's on a different level.
We're just comedy nerds.
Than many humans.
Yeah, no, that's fourth level of Spock, Chuck.
I've got that with some things. I've got that with some things, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm curious, what are some of them?
Yeah.
I love Willow.
Well, you're welcome.
I didn't love, even offer him the Willow mug.
Yeah.
Oh, damn it.
Oh, man, there's a Willow mug.
If we'd only known.
We used to come in and I
forgot about that. Yeah. You know, before we had the chat show mugs, it was my idea to have mugs from movies that Kevin was in. So there was like a Grumpy Old Men mug, a Willow mug.
No kidding.
And there was an, I forget what the other one was. No. Oh, no, End of Days was the other mug.
That's right. That's awesome.
So Willow is one of those for you.
I love Willow. And Willow is kind of, there's an interesting world of movies that came out when I was coming up, growing up, and I think Spaceballs is one.
Oh, yeah.
Where
Shane Mack and I quote Spaceballs quite a bit.
Apparently, they were not viewed as much of a success as I assumed.
We've had this discussion.
Oh, yeah,
here's
okay.
The breakdown. For people of a certain age, like my old self, when Spaceballs came out, it was after Mel Brooks had a row and a run mm-hmm. of, you know, Young Frankenstein.
Yeah. These real classics.
Yeah. So the point is, to audiences that were already deep into their 20s mm-hmm. or 30s, when Spaceballs came around, it was easy to dismiss it mm-hmm. as more silly than comedically profound.
Right.
And there was no Gene Wilder,
mm-hmm.
who is the absolute heart, soul, and embodiment of the best Mel Brooks could ever offer anything.
Yeah, yeah.
And also, Blazing Saddles may have been a great parody of the Western,
mm-hmm.
but this was a parody of a movie. And Mel Brooks
right.
hadn't, you know, you could say Young Frankenstein, but it's not really a parody of the movie mm-hmm, Frankenstein.
Mm-hmm.
Not really. It's a retelling, right. a reimagining, whereas Spaceballs really is
mm-hmm.
all these touchstone moments, merchandising,
mm-hmm.
you know, all those things. And to sophisticated Mel Brooks fans was like,
what?
But to a generation who didn't have that history, or maybe saw Spaceballs on VHS or cable or whatever it ran over and over, they didn't have. Did you guys see it in the theater?
I saw it in the theater.
No.
You didn't have to, is my point.
No, this is definitely HBO for me.
HBO Spaceballs?
Yeah, that was one of those ones I was watching on HBO. Constantly.
But you probably saw it over and over again.
Saw it over and over
right.
again.
And that didn't happen in the theater.
Yeah, and it was yeah, I mean, you nailed it. It was the introduction to Mel Brooks' style
right.
of comedy, and of course, like, the production value is just ridiculous for
yeah.
a comedy,
yeah.
something like quite like that.
Yeah.
And yeah, so that's I'm fascinated with that world of movies that I've talked to people that work on the show, you know. Keegan is, you know, he's got maybe 8 years on me,
mm.
and so he kind of passes that. He's over that cutoff where he's like, yeah, nah. Spaceballs, nah. You know, to me, I was sure this was the best movie that I'd ever.
Right.
This was like Citizen Kane
of comedy.
Of comedy. I love Star Wars and stuff. Yeah.
I think also maybe for the older generation, we already had Airplane.
Right.
You know?
So they had nailed that.
And we
that.
Had the... That's not what Mel Brooks was
but
to us.
The crazy thing about Airplane is it's still wildly popular today.
Yep.
I haven't met a single person under 40 who's familiar with the movies Airplane is spoofing.
Right.
Mm. Oh.
That's a good point.
Those disaster films, yeah.
They don't know Airport 77 yeah. and...
until you
or Towering Inferno.
Or Towering... They don't, yeah, they don't know any of those...
Genre.
Until this moment, I did not realize that was what was going on.
I can't think of a better way to wrap up the show.
Right.
I think when you hit a moment like that...
You hit a moment...
You don't top it.
I've learned something today.
Yeah, what more can I ask?
And, well done. Good.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Honestly and truly.
Honestly.
I'm glad you were able to win your ride home. We didn't get to the astonishing accomplishment of yours of living in Los Angeles for 11 years, refusing to learn how to drive.
Refusing.
Right. And succeeding.
I do have my learner's permit now. So.
But you're not driving.
No.
You're succeeding in a town more so than maybe any other place in the world where if you're not driving, mm-hmm. how the fuck are you existing? 11 years at it.
I also never had a headshot. Anything where people are telling me, first thing you got, you have to.
Driver's license, headshot. Which one first? I don't even know.
I don't know.
They're equally important.
But when I take my driver's license picture, I'm going to give him one of these.
So you never
did get both at the same
You never
time.
Did the commercial composite photo either?
I never did that.
Jamie suggested that I have a party where people bring their commercial composite. Because I had the four, well, one like a pizza place. The dough in the air. One with fishing tackle and a pole. With a tennis racket.
Yeah. No, props.
Yeah, phone call. Phone booth, because that was a thing.
Oh, my God. Does that really work? People are like,
Now I see it.
I can see it.
I didn't think this was in his range until you showed me this composite. He can
hold a tennis racket. Yeah.
I didn't see him as a construction worker, but he can pull it off.
But he can pull it off.
I didn't think Italian, and then I see this move. He's no longer a Jew.
Yeah, right. Those are great.
11 years. Can you surmise your stick-to-itiveness, first of all? Why you refuse to cave? It can't just be fear.
Summarize. No, there's a... Summarize?
It's not summarize?
You meant to say summarize.
Please summarize.
I was totally following you.
Summarize means to take a guess.
Yeah, don't take a guess. She's not right. Please don't guess.
Stubbornness?
Yeah, summarize. Thank you.
There's...
stubbornness. You know. By the way, was the correct answer so hot?
You know, Paul F. Tompkins was an L.A. native and a non-driver, I believe, for over 20 years.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah. I think he only recently, within the last, I'm going to say,
four or five years.
Has been driving, and he moved here in 94.
We got in a horrible accident within the first
one. Oh, perfect. Well, that's just what he wants to hear.
I'm done.
Well, not even sure
it
will never happen.
But now you've got Uber X.
Uber X, definitely.
You're done. Yeah, you needn't ever...
You put me
ever...
on blast on that Uber X? let's say, I go black car, Uber black car. Yeah, no.
It's more Malcolm X than Uber X.
The thing about Uber that drives you crazy, by the way...
Please.
...is when I finish a ride and they go, hey, give me the
five stars.
If you have to ask...
Guess
Come
what?
On, man.
You're getting three. Yeah.
Right.
For asking.
You're getting three for asking. That's like, I don't know, that's like being at a... Sam? No. That's like being on a date and saying, just making sure I'm still on track to getting laid after, you know, or something
it's,
like that.
It's literally, it's being a stand-up and at the end of every joke going, you guys like that one?
You like
that?
Yeah.
Yeah. You guys like that one? All right, here's another one.
Yeah. Magician.
But, Uber... is now my personal driver.
Yeah. Do you not do the Uber X?
I do Uber X. Okay. You nailed it.
I don't need a fancy car. I just need a ride.
Yeah.
And I need a ride by a reputable company.
Yeah.
And that was kind of the beauty of Uber X for me.
Yeah. It's a really good one. And I had done the regular Uber for a while before I realized, Uber X is about a third the price.
Yeah. Why are they even offering?
Yeah. What's the catch? It's very cheap.
Yeah.
Very cheap.
Well, I'm happy to say you'll get home with your winnings, I think.
I'll end up with four of these dollars.
Will you? Get a little change back?
I'll get a little change.
I love that. Actually, you're keeping the whole thing that's going on your credit card. I think we've talked enough about UberX.
They're not even a sponsor.
I only have one last thing for you to do.
Okay.
It is a part of the show that has been kept secret from you until now. I'm not sure why. Mm-mm. We wrap up the show in the same way each and every time by asking the guest to play the Larry King game, much easier than who tweeted, because I just want the guest to reenact that wonderful moment when Larry King had a television program on the CNN. And he would look into the camera before going to the phones. He'd look into the camera and share something about himself. And every time, it was something that no one needed to know. Mm-hmm. We want one of those moments. We want you to give me a bad Larry King impression. I don't want a good one. A bad one makes me laugh.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then act out that moment where Larry shared something about himself into the camera that no one wanted to know. Make it up, and then go to the phones, and if the name of the city is funny sounding that you go to, it's going to help the bit just a little.
Okay.
A lot of pressure.
And I'm sharing something about myself,
not
Larry King.
You're sharing something about Larry. I'm glad you asked.
Me too.
It's only happened only one other time where the guest, it was our first guest, did, so I'm glad you asked. So you're impersonating Larry, and in Larry's mind and voice, you share something as Larry, about Larry, to the home audience, and then go to the phones. That's the whole Larry King game in a nutshell. There's your camera. When you're ready, have at it.
Okay. I'm Larry King. When I was 8 years old, I realized my father and I shared a penis construction. Shape and size. Raleigh, North Carolina. North Carolina? South Carolina? Raleigh. You're on.
Oh, that's how you play the Larry King game. Ladies and Jews.
Thank you.
Please be seated.
Very fun.
Thank you. Sit there uncomfortably, if you would, while I wrap things up for the folks at home, but thank you.
First guest to do it.
That's very uncomfortable.
He's trying to make himself uncomfortable.
Thank you for that. All right. Next week, tune in for our guest host, live streaming on the YouTube, Mr. Dana Gould, guest to be named. And then after that, I believe I will be back here on the 18th, and then we pick it up again. I will take Memorial off and then come back with Paget Brewster as my guest host on the 1st of June. I believe it's the 1st?
It sure is.
More of this information to come your way. Until next time, I want to thank Kenny, Sammy, and Jamie, the three E's here in the studio. J-Mac and Negnog out there. Samantha Ward, makeup artist extraordinaire. Danielle.
Nice.
Overland, proud of me?
You bet I am.
Sure.
So are our listeners.
And we missed our David Mandel horribly, the greatest intern in the history of show business, at his sister's wedding.
Yeah, had to go to sister's wedding. What's
What a horrible thing to have to do.
Other than come here for free.
He should have broken up that marriage.
rather than come here for free, good point. Yeah, well, maybe his breaking up the marriage. Let's hope.
All right.
Yeah. Until next time, and as always... get out of my face. That would have been a better sign-off if I'd done that.